Hi. So thank you for joining us today for our workshop. I hope you guys enjoyed the talk so far and the breakout session. And again, thank you for joining us despite how nice it is outside today. So our next talk is from a man who needs no introduction, but I've been told I need to do it anyways. So Professor Feng Zhang will give us a nice talk about the challenges of genome editing. And I just want to say, you know, I was a PhD student of Feng's for 5 years. I just defended earlier last year. And when I first started in 2014, this workshop was really just this tiny thing we had on the second floor with a bunch of tables. And it's really amazing to see how large it's grown. And we've taken over the whole lobby. So it's really amazing. And I think we have a great set of talks. And with no further ado, Dr. Feng Zhang.
Okay, well, thank you for the introduction, Omar. First of all, welcome to the Broad Institute and welcome to Cambridge. It's really, we're delighted to have you here. But before I dive in, I just want to acknowledge my lab members and also, in particular, Rihanna McCree, who almost single-handedly put the program together and organized this event. So without her hard work, I think the event wouldn't be nearly as successful as we have today. So thank you for all coming. So I was asked by Rhiannon, who is really the boss, to give a talk. And I told her that I'll follow orders and do whatever the boss tells me to do. So I was thinking what I can talk about, because the purpose for this workshop is to have, in particular, my lab members and also other members of the genome editing field who are working on developing these technologies to be around, to be able to share the nitty-gritties, the technical know-hows of how to do these experiments. And we just heard three really phenomenal talks so far on applying the basic editing technology to doing screens and then to RNA targeting. And I thought there's not that much left for me to talk about. So what I put together is just some basic information on what are some of the challenges that we still face in the genome editing field. We have come a long way in developing tools and applying the tools to study biology or to address disease, but there's still a long way to go. And so what are some of these things that we need to continue to address? And that's what I'm hoping to cover today. So one of the motivations for developing gene editing has been the rapid advances in sequencing of human DNA. The first human genome costed hundreds of millions of dollars to complete. And since then, technology for sequencing DNA has dropped in cost precipitously. And so nowadays, we can sequence a full human genome, mapping almost every letter of it for less than $1,000. And so with this power of sequencing and mapping genetic sequences, we can now collect DNA sequence from hundreds of thousands or maybe millions of individuals. And by comparing their genomes, a number of different genetic variations have been identified. And so here, this just shows some of the things that are underlying genetic diseases, or what's called rare diseases. So to date, there are about 7,000 different genetic variations that underlie specific diseases. These are usually single mutations that can lead to very devastating consequences. Examples of these include sickle cell disease or hemophilia and many other monogenic genetic disease. So as we start to identify these disease-causing variations, one tantalizing thought is, why don't we go into the cells and fix them? If we can replace what is defective and change it to be the ones that are found in people who are not affected by those diseases, then we may be able to treat these illnesses. And so this very idea has undergone a series of evolutionary developments. And so nowadays, what we really think about is either doing gene therapy or cell therapy. Gene therapy being strategies to go into the body to fix specific mutations in vivo and to be able to treat disease. And cell therapy are strategies where we take cells out of the body, repair them so that we can put fix cells back into the patient, or we can take cells, engineer them so that they become little therapeutic machines that you can put into the patient to be able to correct diseases. Examples of that include CAR-T therapy where you are changing immune cells to get them to recognize tumor cells and to be able to treat disease. And so this idea of gene or cell therapy is what people across the field has been developing. And just this year, the most recent American Society for Cell and Gene Therapy meeting had a record number of participants, more than 10,000. And just compared to 4 years ago, the number of people who participated has doubled. And so this really rapid advance in gene and cell therapy is very exciting. And this highlights the potential that this field has for developing new treatments. When it comes to gene therapy, the standard strategy that folks are practicing now involve the use of viruses. And using viruses, you can deliver full gene products that can replace defective genes in the body to be able to give rise to a therapeutic outcome. The very first gene therapy that was successful is for the treatment of SCID, which is an immune deficiency disorder. And the way this was done is you take cells out of kids who are affected by SCID, fix them, and then transplant them back. The initial way of doing these gene therapy is using retroviruses, which are viruses that can integrate genes into the genome of those cells. And this provides a permanent replacement strategy for those patients who don't have the gene. But these retroviral vectors sometimes can have problems. The first generation came from viruses that cause cancer, and so they can randomly insert themselves into regions that may lead to cancer. And so in fact, when the first round of SCID trials were done, it was discovered that in a fraction of the patients who were treated, they developed cancer. And so that nevertheless still showed that if we can deliver genes or therapeutic genes into the body, then there is a way to be able to treat disease. And so since then, new vectors have been developed, and a lot of the latest generation vectors are much, much safer. But gene therapy is only for the replacement of genes. What if you can just add in a new copy of the gene? What if you have to really fix it by repairing the sequence? And that's where the development of gene editing technology came in. And so multiple iterations of the technology has been developed. So some of you may have heard of something called meganuclease, or zinc finger nuclease, or TALENs, or CRISPR-Cas. And these are different iterations of technology that have been developed over the past couple of decades that take advantage of one idea, which is if you can make double-stranded breaks in the genome, then you can stimulate the cell to activate repair machineries and to be able to switch in new sequences or to be able to disrupt deleterious proteins. So all four of these systems are nucleases. Meganucleases are naturally occurring proteins that recognize long strings of sequences and be able to make double-strand breaks. And this nuclease has been harnessed through direct evolution to be able to change the sequence of DNA that this protein can recognize. But it's not a trivial process. In fact, even with a lot of very, very complicated, sophisticated technology, there's no guarantee that you can make a nuclease do what you want it to do. And so to solve this challenge of reprogramming the meganuclease to recognize a new sequence, zinc finger nucleases became another platform that was developed for recognizing different DNA sequences. But these zinc finger proteins, they're modular, so each one of these finger modules recognizes three DNA bases. And the idea, at least on paper, is that you can chain them together to form a zinc finger array and recognize a long stretch of DNA sequence. That modularity, unfortunately, was not as people predicted. So when you put two fingers next to each other, sometimes they can affect the activity of their neighboring finger module. And so that means if you have two fingers, each one of them with known DNA recognition specificity, when you put them together, the sum of these two fingers is not necessarily 1 plus 1 equals 2. It gives you some effect that you can't exactly predict. And so, nevertheless, zinc finger is much easier to reprogram than make a nuclease, and it has been developed to edit a number of different genes and show the possibility that we can have programmable nucleases allow us to edit genomes with high levels of efficiency and also relative specificity. So to further make this system easier, another protein-based DNA binding domain called tail was also discovered from bacteria. These tail proteins are modular, where the individual modules recognize single DNA bases. So it's simpler in terms of how many modules there are than zinc finger proteins. And in an analogous way, by taking these tail binding domains to bring FOLC1 nuclease domains, scientists have also turned these into programmable DNA binding domains that can cleave target sequences. And so as we go from meganuclease to zinc finger nuclease and then to TALEN, this became easier and easier to do. And then ultimately, when CRISPR-Cas9 was harnessed for gene editing, this is probably the easiest system, because rather than having to engineer proteins, these nucleases can be reprogrammed by simply giving a short piece of RNA. And these RNA guides can be synthesized synthetically. You can go online to IDT or any other oligosynthesis company and order that specific oligonucleotide. And so when you look at the progression of these technologies, we have really gone from something that's really difficult to use to become something that's much, much easier to use. And that's the progression so far in terms of carrying out gene editing. And going from, so as we began to explore, or as the field began to explore different versions of DNA, programmable DNA binding domains, the system became easier. And then some of the things that the field has been doing in the recent years is to go beyond Cas9 to see what else is there besides this Cas9 protein. And so here is the crystal structure of Cas9. You can see this is one of these CRISPR effectors. In the recent years, a number of new CRISPR effectors have also been discovered and also developed. So here is something called CPF1. Now it's renamed to be Cas12a. It's also RNA-guided DNA nuclease that can do similar things as Cas9, but also has some differences. And then there's Cas12b, Cas12e, and then besides the DNA targeting ones, there are also RNA targeting ones that can use RNA guides to recognize RNA molecules. And so these began to allow researchers to develop a whole set of different tools to target either DNA for manipulation or be able to target RNA for manipulation. In their natural form, most of these, all of these on the slide are nucleases. They either cleave DNA or they cleave RNA. But in addition to using the nuclease function of these systems, they can also be used for tethering to recruit effector modules. So here is the use of these nucleases to be able to cleave DNA, but you can also modify these proteins so that they only recognize DNA, but they sit there instead of cutting the DNA. And so you can use these to recruit different effector modules to specific sites. So if you bring a repressive domain like CRAB, you can turn genes off rather than cutting that gene and mutating it. You can bring transcription activators to be able to turn genes on or modify the local epigenetic state, changing DNA methylation or chromatin modification. And also you can even edit specific DNA bases by bringing silent deaminases or adding deaminases to be able to do what's called base editing. And so this is a general strategy to be able to begin to develop a variety of different applications. So one of the most exciting things for these technologies to turn into a real therapeutic. How do we deliver and use these enzyme systems to be able to correct disease-causing genetic variants or to be able to modify cells so that we can reprogram them to have therapeutic applications? And so some of the important criteria that face the development of these therapeutic strategies are the efficacy of the system. So how many cells can we modify, or can we modify enough cells correctly to be able to achieve therapeutic outcome? And then how specific can we achieve these editing activities? Are we able to exclusively modify the variation without changing anything else that's in the genome? And if we are changing other things in the genome, do they have any deleterious consequences? And so that's the second thing. And then the third is most of these proteins are from microbial sources, so they're foreign to our body. And if we're introducing them into the human body for therapeutic purposes, how will our immune system recognize or how will our immune system reject these microbial proteins? And so the theme of this year's workshop is in vivo genome editing. And so a lot of the discussions tomorrow will focus around how do we get sufficient efficacy, or how do we achieve enough specificity, and also how do we think about this immunological challenge. And so a lot of the speakers tomorrow have done a lot of really thoughtful work around understanding these problems, and I think we'll have a very productive discussion tomorrow. And so another major challenge is delivery. These are oftentimes macromolecules that are quite large, large molecular weight. And so how do we effectively or efficiently introduce them into cells or into specific organs in the body? These gene editing therapeutics can be carried out either through in vivo delivery, so directly introducing that into a specific organ like the liver or the brain, or you can achieve ex vivo editing, where you take cells out of the patient, modify them in a petri dish, and then be able to transplant the cells back into the patient. So far, delivery technologies work fairly well for these ex vivo treatments. If you take T cells or you take hematopoietic stem cells, you can use something called electroporation to zap the cells, rupture their membrane, and then introduce the material into the cells. So for ex vivo, there are some pretty good methodologies. But when it comes to in vivo delivery, the challenges are enormous. Practically speaking, only a small set of organs we can deliver to. Using viruses, we can deliver into the liver. And then if we try to target the eye, we can locally inject into the retina to be able to treat diseases there. But most other organs, we really don't have good delivery systems. If you want to target the kidney, or if you want to target all of the muscle cells in the body, for the kidney, we don't have vectors that can go there efficiently. For the muscle, our biomass is really quite enormous, and we don't have good ways to be able to manufacture enough vectors to make this practical or economical. And so there are a lot of challenges that face delivery, and this is one thing that some of the speakers will touch on tomorrow, but as a field, we still need to develop new solutions to be able to address. So far, the development of genome editing technology has really made quite a bit of progress along this axis of reprogrammability. Meganucleases have made a system, have shown that it's possible, and then zinc fingers and talons have gotten it to be easier, and then Cas9, Cas12, and Cas13 based systems have made it even easier. But it made it easier to be able to retarget to a new DNA or RNA sequence. But in terms of the capabilities of the different types of edits that we want to achieve, whether it's and all these are nucleases, so they can make double-strand breaks and stimulate gene disruption quite effectively. But if you want to introduce new DNA sequences into the genome to stimulate homology directed repair, or to be able to duplicate genes, or to be able to mimic large translocations within the genome, those capabilities higher up on the capability side still lack solutions, and we still need to work on making those things feasible. And so both in terms of improving the existing system, as well as developing the delivery systems, and also increasing our capability of being able to make all sorts of types of edits in the cells, these are challenges that we as a field still need to develop. And hopefully some of the discussions tomorrow, and also the discussions that you will have amongst yourselves during breakout sessions or during break time can lead to some of these new solutions. One exciting area that we draw a lot of inspiration from in our own research, but also many other folks are exploring this rich resource of materials is the bacterial and archaeal sequence diversity. This is from NCBI, so you can see the number of genomes or bacterial genomes that have been completed so far or as of last year. And this is a very rapidly increasing database of information. And so there are a lot of different bacteria that live in all sorts of diverse ecological environments. And for each one of them to survive and to be able to prosper, they had to evolve interesting systems that allow them to be able to cope with the condition that they that's in their own environment. And so by exploring these different survival mechanisms that the different bacterial species use, it's very likely that we may be able to discover new solutions to gene editing. And in fact, if you think about the solution that came so far, whether it's zinc fingers or tails or CRISPR diversity, they all came from nature's own inventions, different ways of developing systems to allow them to defend against different infections. And so exploring this wealth of information will likely also lead to novel solutions for any of these challenges facing gene editing-based therapeutics. As we chart forward at unprecedented pace to develop technologies, ethics of gene editing is also a major consideration. I think most of us learned last November that scientists have edited human embryos and even implanted them to give a birth to two genetically modified baby girls. And the use of gene editing technology in this diverse array of possible applications really requires very thoughtful consideration, thinking about the ethics and the consequences of these actions on the development of society in the future. And so as scientists, both developing technology and applying them, we not only have a responsibility to use them to improve human health, but also we have a responsibility to society to think about how we can best use the technology and how we can inform and also communicate the power and also the potential disadvantage of the technology to the society. So all that's to say, there's a lot of work ahead of us. There's work on the science, work on the medicine, work on the biology, but also work as members of society to make sure that we are using technology in responsible ways. So that's all I have prepared for today. But last but not least, I just want to acknowledge that science is a team sport. It wouldn't be possible without my lab members, and this workshop certainly wouldn't have been possible without all of these lab members who are around to transfer their expertise and knowledge, and also to help answer the questions that some of you may have brought with you. And I'm really looking forward to interacting with all of you. And also tomorrow, hopefully, we'll be able to make some good progress on solving some of these challenges, or at least paving the way to solving some of these challenges. Thank you again for coming, and look forward to a great meeting tomorrow.
Oh, sure. So, yeah. So.